All right, so as many of you guys know, I'm Michael, and this is my wife, Lisa. And this is our first time. I actually get to be on the camera tonight. I always say, hey, the camera's not for you. You're sitting out there, and I'm usually out there, but tonight I get to be on the camera, so this is exciting. We're just super happy to and excited to be able to share and glorify God tonight just by telling you guys how he was able to reach out and to take us out of this world and into his everlasting kingdom. And so I'm going to start out and share my testimony with you, and then I'm going to pause and give my wife a chance to share her story, and then we'll go into a little message that you guys can talk about as you break out into small groups later. So as far back as I can remember, I was told about God. I grew up hearing all the stories from the Bible that you would hear in any children's Sunday school classroom. I was even told the gospel of Jesus Christ and how he died on a cross for the sins of the world. I grew up believing in God and knowing things about him, but I did not know him or have a personal relationship with him. I was from a fairly large family in relation to those I saw around me. I was the second eldest of five children, and both of my parents were at home. My dad was dead serious about God and the Bible. My mother supported my dad's efforts to raise us in the church and have us surrounded by activities that incorporated God's word and such. This characterized my childhood and very young adolescent years. Along the way, I also learned about heaven and hell. I came to understand that heaven was where God was, and hell was where God would send the sinners who didn't repent. In my misunderstanding, I came to believe that God was just seething with anger at me for my sin, and that repenting meant I would not sin and would have to behave correctly all the time. As I began to grow up, I found myself getting into trouble on a pretty regular basis. I would get disciplined for my wrong behavior and told that I was loved, but that didn't help me out of my sin problem. What I learned was that there were consequences to my actions if I got caught. In my elementary years, I would attempt to course correct, but always found sin lurking around inside of me. I found that sin stuck to me rather easily and came quite naturally. Later, I reconciled that I even liked to sin from time to time. I knew that God hated sin and that those who persisted in it were doomed to hell, to burn in the lake of fire forever. Even still, I found it impossible for me to quit sinning and to even want to. I figured for myself that I was stuck where I was at and damned of God because of my failure and evil desires. So I got really good at running away and hiding with my sin. This eventually led me into a life dominated by drug and alcohol abuse. I would stay all alone, aside from other sinners on the same course as me, hiding in my sin. Through prolonged use, my life went into irreversible despair. I was lonely, depressed, and entertained suicide on a regular basis. I assumed I would die and go to hell, and that God's anger would be fully released on me for all the sins I'd committed. At this point, the hell I'd heard about from the preachers didn't seem much worse than the life I'd come to know. In my limited understanding, I could not turn to God, who was angry with me. I could not escape the chains of my sin, and so I was left completely hopeless. I got to a place in life where I literally was waiting to die. My life had turned into a vicious cycle of wake up, go to work, drink myself to sleep, and repeat. I remember saying to myself, I'm just going to drink until I die, and that's it. To give a little bit of a backdrop, my family had discovered the state of being that I was in and had longed to get some kind of help for me. They literally did not know where to turn. I remember about a year prior to this, my mother had come across these men out doing a fundraiser for a place called Teen Challenge. They had informed her about what it was and given her some kind of brochure about the place. I remember she showed it to me and I scoffed at it. Little did I know, this was going to be an avenue God would use to get me where he had already planned. I've shared with you my broken perception of who God was and how I learned to think about him. You see the places and sin that I ran to escape the fear. This was all about to drastically change. At this time, I was managing a small gas station, not much bigger than a bedroom in a house. I used to sit in there all day and drink while I was pulling my shift. I would usually read the paper first while I started my shift to distract me from starting drinking. Once I was done with the paper, out came the beers. So I'm finishing up the paper one day and starting to crack my first beer. And all of a sudden, out of nowhere, I get this impression echoing inside me. All I hear is Teen Challenge over and over. I can't shake this from my mind. I'm literally beside myself thinking, what is going on? I get Teen Challenge. Aside from maybe a couple of foxhole prayers in earlier years, I never really spoke to God. I all of a sudden in that moment looked up and I said, God, you want me to go into Teen Challenge? Boom, Teen Challenge. It got even louder and louder and it just kept going. I realized God was talking to me. I remember with the echoing being in the affirmative that Teen Challenge is where God wanted me to go, at first began to throw up excuses as to why I could not go into this Teen Challenge. Quickly, though, I realized as a hopeless individual, I had zero good excuses. I immediately said yes. I can't begin to describe the peace that filled my heart and mind. Most all of my life up to this point was lived in fear of God, and not the kind of fear the Bible describes as the beginning of wisdom. That he would stoop down and talk to this worthless, wicked sinner flipped my paradigm of what and how I thought of God. In the following month, I dropped all my plans, which were very few. I left the drugs, alcohol, and fear and followed God's leading. I went into Teen Challenge, where once again, I heard the gospel of Jesus Christ. For the first time, I was able to see that Christ died for my sins. When I believed God, he breathed new life into me, and that was the life of his Son. I was a new creation. Christ had come and taken up residence in me. As I began to open God's word, he began to open himself up to me. Jesus had become my center. Isaiah 61 describes very well what I was experiencing. He gave me beauty for ashes, joy for mourning, and a garment of praise in place of despair. With this new life and new hope, everything began to change for me in a very dramatic way. I was on fire, as they say. I would share with anyone willing to listen about how my life went from despair and addiction to total peace and excitement about the future. That the love God has for us, shown in Christ, will change your life. I saw God in a completely new light than I had ever known. This new journey all started in August of the year 2000, which, side note, I turned 23 in the year 2000, and this is August, 23 years later today that I'm sharing this story with you. I don't know what that means. I'm not going to read into it. I went on to make a public profession of faith in Christ the following year and got baptized. I eventually graduated Teen Challenge. I got very involved in a local church. I went into Bible college for a year and went on various missions trips. I was walking with the Lord and loving my new life. I would love to sit here and tell you that the last 23 years of my life went perfect. That would be a lie. I had no idea the work yet needing to be done. Aside from learning correct doctrine and how to interpret the Word of God, my flesh, as you hear Paul wrestle with in Romans chapter 7, was very much an issue. I went through some very difficult years battling for the faith, winning some and losing a lot. I came to understand that being born again happens in a moment, but learning to walk in spirit and truth is a growing, maturing progress. It really does mimic the natural realm in that we have to learn how to crawl, walk, feed ourselves, and so on. You also may have heard that the Christian life is a marathon rather than a sprint. I've also found that to be true. I would encourage anyone who has just began this journey to stay broken and humble, remain teachable, and forgive quickly. With that, I'm going to allow my wife to share her story with you. So go ahead, baby.
Yeah, Thank you for letting us share God's perfect plan for our lives. This is my story for His glory. So I was raised going to church. My understanding of God was my own. I thought that He was a fairy tale or a fantasy character. I did not believe that He was real. Growing up, I always felt like I deserved more. I would look at other families and covet what they had. I always wanted more than what I was given. I felt very empty and always longing for more. So to fill the emptiness, I started using cigarettes, drugs, and alcohol at a very young age, not realizing the damage that I was creating. I was not filling the emptiness. I was just creating more. The middle of my senior year, my twin brother died in a car train accident at the age of 17. At this point in my life, I was really struggling with addiction. The tragedy drove me even stronger into it. This was definitely a turning point in my life, but it wasn't a good one. I chose to run from God, shake my fist, and run to my addiction. This I could control. I thought, if God is so real and so good, why would He choose to leave me and take my brother? He was such a good person. I graduated from high school and went into my career as a cosmetologist, living a double life. That double life caught up with me, creating a hardened heart, chaos, insecurity, pain, and confusion. Chasing after this world and going my own way left me empty and thirsty, longing for more. Anything I could do to fill the void, I did. I got pregnant with my son at the age of 26. All the drugs and alcohol stopped while I was pregnant by God's grace. I had a beautiful child. That I had no idea what to do with or how to raise. So the best way that I knew how to deal with that fear and uncertainty was to run to drugs and alcohol to numb anything that I was feeling. So those began to slowly creep back into my life. At the age of 30, my son was 5. I found myself sitting on my couch being investigated for child neglect. My lifestyle was about to ruin my son's life. God used this situation in my life to bring me to the end of myself and made me realize just how far my sin had taken me. By God's grace, I was unfounded, but this was definitely my rock bottom. So my last resort was God. I started seeking at different churches and thought, if I go sit in His congregation, then He'll give me what I want. So in my brokenness, I went searching. One night, my cousin and his wife saw that I was struggling. They asked me to come over for dinner, and my cousin's wife took me through Romans Road. They also shared their testimonies of how Christ had personally saved them. That night, I went home and I tucked my son into bed and I watched him sleep. He looked so peaceful. I thought to myself, he doesn't deserve to live the way I've chosen to live. I kissed him on the forehead and I walked into my room and I laid down in my bed. Broken, I cried out to God. I told Him I've made a mess of my life and have no idea how to clean it up. I need you to come into my life, and I believe Jesus died for my sins. He was buried, and he rose again. I took the Romans Road scripture to heart. Romans 10, 8 through 10, or 8 through 10, verse 13. But what does it say? The word is near you, in your mouth and in your heart. That is the word of faith that we proclaim. Because if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, and you believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For with the heart one believes and is justified, and with the mouth one confesses and is saved. Everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. For the first time, I started to see the sin in my life as sin. I believe that night, God saved me. The next night, I tried to drink, and I felt like I had been caught doing something wrong. I was arrested and convicted by the Holy Spirit. God intervened in a way that was completely undeniable that it was him. It has been 14 years since God has given me victory over drugs and alcohol.
Praise
God. God has taken away the desire to run to my addiction and gave me a desire to run to him. Over this time, God has taught me through his word that he is the center of my life no matter where I am in life, whether I'm single, whether I'm married, as a mom, or as a daughter of a king. He is my first love. He has filled that emptiness that I so deeply long to fill. I am forever grateful for my singleness and the trials. I have learned so much about God and who he is throughout all of it. He has taught me to trust him, to run to him, and to cling to him. Thank you.
Thank you, baby. So, in 2020, I found myself in a place of desperation. I pled with the Lord to rescue me from the sins I was entangled in once again. He answered my prayer and completely wiped out my desire for those sins. I came to realize that the Lord had been working something deep inside of me all these years. All this struggling with my flesh and wrestling through different understandings of Scripture came to a halt. He showed me that victory is a man, and that man is Christ Jesus. In the Gospel of John, John the Baptist says in chapter 3, verse 30, he says, he must increase, but I must decrease. That funny little word, but, in there really makes all the difference. Christ can only increase if the I is decreasing. Obviously, we don't disappear. But myself, mind, will, and emotions must decrease so that Christ's mind, will, and emotions can take center stage. With that being said, I would like to go into our talk this evening about Christ as our center. Prior to my wife and I getting married, we went through a book called Tying the Knot by Rob Green. In this book, you are challenged to look into many aspects of marriage and what that biblically looks like with Christ as the center. We were asked to talk a little about that, being that we have literally been married 7 months yesterday. We both have more examples of our hearts being captured by Christ prior to our marriage. We're still growing in our relationship and communication, but nonetheless, our marriage is greatly benefited by us both having Christ as our center. As Lisa and I prayed about this message, we both were led to the Gospel of John in chapter 15. We both saw that the only fruit that bore out in our lives, both individually and as a couple, was from the Lord's abiding life within us. We're going to look at that through Scripture and talk about Christ as our center. Our text for this evening is going to be John chapter 15, verses 1 through 17. I want you to read that full text when you break out into small groups. But for the sake of time, I'm going to have my wife just read verses 4 and 5. Honey, can you please read that?
Abide in me and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine and you are the branches. Whoever abides in me, I in him, and he it is that bears much fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing.
So in our text, we hear this word abide being used frequently. We decided to look more into this word to get a better understanding of its meaning. A couple of words that stuck out to us were that it means to remain or to stay. So if you're a born-again, believing Christian, then this abiding life is where God has called you to remain or stay. A few characteristics we've drawn out of this and what it looks like would be constant communion, total dependence, and complete adoration. I'm going to go through kind of a just list of some scriptures and stuff that I felt like stuck out that point to this constant communion that the Lord calls us into. To look at the first point, constant communion, listen to what the Lord says. In John 15:5, the Lord says, I am the vine, you are the branches. I highlighted the word are. That is a declarative statement. It is a promise. He's not asking us to try and be a branch, but that we already are his branches. It is a state of being, an intimate union. Another promise of his that speaks to that is in Hebrews chapter 13, verse 5. It says that he will never leave nor desert us, declaring that we are forever connected to him. Being that closely connected gives you a sense of complete security, and by faith you know you are never alone. Also, in the book of Romans, chapter 8, verses 31 through 39, it declares that God is for us. He is on our side. He is always for us. And it also declares that it is literally impossible for anything. Anything. It goes into a litany of all these different things to separate us from him. Separate us from his love. Well, God is love, so separate us from him. Nothing can separate us from him. Standing on these promises is something that we must repent to on a daily basis. I know that when you're first born again, this does not just come naturally. We are independent agents naturally, and so it takes a major paradigm shift, or which is just a way of seeing things, to begin to walk as one with the Lord. I remember after I had been saved, I was ready to get to work. We're always ready to get busy doing something, aren't we? It takes time to learn this communion and to understand that our doings come out of our being. I want to encourage you as new believers to not get discouraged at your imperfections, but to hold on tightly to God's promises and wait upon him to bring about the fruit. In 2 Corinthians chapter 12, 7 through 10, Paul reveals that God allows our weaknesses to remain, one, so that we don't become braggarts, and secondly, to reveal his grace in us. I get it that it is still frustrating as a Christian when we fall into sin. 1 John tells us to confess our sins, be cleansed, then get back up and put your sights back on the vine. Our mission verse that we read every week from Romans 12:2 says we will transform as we are renewed in our minds and that we will know the will of God. In my younger years, I was discipled in my faith to think of my mind as a garden. Whatever you're sowing into that garden, you are reaping. And I was challenged, sure, you're reaping today what you sowed yesterday, but what are you sowing today for the harvest that you want to reap tomorrow? Let's look at another verse from Scripture. 1 Thessalonians 5, 16 through 18 says, God's will for us is to rejoice always, pray without ceasing, and to give thanks in all things. That's God's will for your life. Rejoice always. Pray without ceasing. Give thanks in all things. It is just another call to abide continually in communion with our Lord. I want to look at one last verse, and maybe the most powerful. 1 John 2:27. It says, "The anointing you receive abides in you, and you have no need that anyone should teach you. But as his anointing teaches you about everything and is true and is no lie, just as he has taught you, abide in him. The Holy Spirit who is with you and in you keeps you abiding in constant communion." The second point that we highlighted up there was that this means total dependence. The picture the Lord gives us here of the vine and branches helps us to visualize what God is telling us. Naturally, you would know if you cut a branch off from the vine that it will shrivel up and die. God tells us in John 15, again, verse 5, that apart from me or apart from him, we can do nothing. I want to make a statement. If you've truly repented, that means you've given up any hope that you have some ability to save yourself. You have placed all your hope, trust, and confidence in our amazing Savior and in what he has accomplished through his life, death, and resurrection. I feel we need to get clear on this. Repentance is not a promise to God that you won't sin anymore. It's an admittance that you can't help but sin and that you need him to save you from your sins. The negative side of this is that we can't do anything ourselves to produce any good fruit. The positive and amazing side of this is that God doesn't expect us to produce anything that he doesn't supply us with first. Every fruit that bears out on a branch is from the sap of the vine. Even so, every fruit that a Christian bears out is from the Holy Spirit, who is the sap, who abides with you and in you. The Holy Spirit is with us. The Holy Spirit with us is what makes all this possible. To me, that's relieving on the positive side and also leaves no room for boasting as if I did anything myself on the negative side, if that's negative. For a prideful man like me, it kind of is. My wife wants to share an example of not depending on the vine and then learning total dependence with you.
So after I was saved, a deep-rooted sin followed me into my Christian walk. It was control. What grew out of that root was anger. I wanted control so bad that I would become out of control. I remember talking to Lori, who disciples me, saying, "I should be able to handle this. I'm a Christian now. I repent, but I still continue to do the same thing." I was still struggling and fighting that sin in my own strength, and it wasn't working. The sin of controlling anger was destroying my son and I. I started seeing my son act out and repeating his mom's behaviors. I knew I needed to fight harder, but not in my own strength. I put on the full armor of God. I got out my belt of truth and the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. I started fighting with God's Word, hanging note cards up all over my kitchen with verses about anger. When I started feeling that fuel of anger, I would read them out loud. You see, I was learning to abide in Him. The more I did this, Christ became greater and I became less. I was nourishing my soul instead of feeding my sin. John 8:31-32 says, "So Jesus said to the Jews who had believed in him, 'If you abide in my word, you are truly my disciples, and you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free.'" As I was thinking back on all of this, I can only give God the glory for his victory in my life. It's only by his grace that the truth has set me free.
Amen. So the third part that we touched on is how this becomes complete adoration. The first thing God does before we become a believing child of God is that he calls us. He calls us to come to him. After we have responded to the call is when the Lord gives us this amazing offer to abide with him. So he first reveals his heart of love for us and then joins us to himself. The amazing gift that God gives to us is that of himself. He grafts us into the Holy Trinity, which is an amazing love relationship that has existed for all time. When we stop and look and peer into what God has made us a part of, it blows your mind. When you see that he is totally other, different than anyone or anything you have ever known, pure, unadulterated love. When you realize this, especially up against your own wicked, nasty self and this crazy fallen world you're a part of, you will crumble. I don't mean in a bad way, but in an unbelievable way. To where you can't help but to worship and adore this loving Savior God who's found you. One of the most powerful parables the Lord told in Luke 15:11-32 is the story of two sons. This changed everything I ever understood about God. For the sake of time, I won't read it, but I suggest you do it on your own and see the heart of the Father revealed. When I was finally able to see that God was always a loving Father and never an angry judge, I finally was able to worship him. Did you know you won't worship, let alone adore, someone you think is angry with you? The goodness of God leads man to repentance, it says in Romans 2. I say, let your heart be seized by the agape love God has for you. Finally, I want to quickly look at the fruit that this chapter has been talking about. The obvious one is love. 1 John 4:19 says we love because we were first loved by him. And then in our text, John 15:13 says, greater love has no one than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends. So first, we will have love for the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Secondly, we will see and have love one for another in the family of faith. Even more amazing is we will be able to begin to love those who are against us. I would like to look at a scripture that also shows us what the fruit of the Spirit is. And I picked this from Galatians 5:22, the Amplified Version, because it says, the fruit of the Spirit, the result of his presence within us, is love, which is unselfish concern for others, joy, inner peace, patience, not the ability to wait, but what we do while, or how we act while we're waiting, kindness, goodness, and faithfulness. Friends, are these fruits bearing out in your life? If not, it could be because of where you're abiding. I've heard it said, if the root is bad, the fruit will be bad. If the root is good, the fruit will be good. What's at the root of your fruit? Maybe it's time for some of us to begin realigning our hearts and minds with Christ. Maybe there's someone here this evening that does not yet have Christ as the root. Remember, God calls you first before you can abide. God makes a completely amazing offer. Give me your sins and I'll give you myself. Is God calling on you tonight? How will you respond to his calling? If you don't know it already, God is a loving Father. His creation is the object of his affection. You are a part of his creation and created to be known and loved by him. I plead with you to drop all your misconception about who God is and see him for the first time this evening through his sacrificed son on your behalf in his attempt to rescue you from destruction. Give up everything you've ever known and run into the arms of your Savior. I pray I'm not merely appealing to your intellect tonight, but that you're hearing these words from God that are spirit and truth. Will you allow Christ to become your center? That's all we got.